because this is an important part of the evening. This isn't a litter pick. I've got to try to get to all these different items to the best of my ability, assisted by Mr. Shellcross, our technician, and your good selves. It's going to be a monologue. There won't be time to engage in discussion or dialogue, unfortunately. A lot to get through. This has got a historical beginning. It's got a look to the future at the end. And the main section is between 1938 and 1988. That's half a century of conservation, natural history, bird watching in this area. So, specs on. The starting point is the year 1892.
No lights up there.
Not yet, George, yet it's okay for 1892. Because in 1892 we get the first reference to the first book which describes the ornithology of both parts of the world, South Lancashire. It's a book called Birds of Lancashire by F.S. Mitchell. He's based in Clitheroe and he gets his information from people in that part of the world. So the Birds of Lancashire in 1892 is primarily birds of North Lancashire and West Lancashire. There's no mention of Lee. There's no mention of South Lancashire, apart from a reference to Warrington and the mosses near Warrington, which I presume would be Holcroft and Rixton, Risley, Little Wolfen Moss, possibly. Now the only references there are descendants of Nightjar, Redback Shrike, Tree Sparrow and Reed Warbler of breeding birds. As for the flash, well, when the first picture comes on, the first map, in a minute or two, you'll see why there's no reference to that. In producing his account of birds in Lancashire, Mr. Mitchell relies upon observers in different places. I've no idea how he gets in touch with them, but they write to him and tell him what they've seen, what their understanding is of the birds of the area. He also relies upon a very, very old publication from 1700 by a man called Dr. Charles Lee. It's got the same way as Lee where we are spelled. And Charles Lee produces this book about Derbyshire, Cheshire and Lancashire birds. Mr. Mitchell uses that to get information, but immediately he points out to the reader that this book contains gross absurdities. In other words, there are people spinning yarns to him. Now, I love that phrase, gross absurdities. And the best example he gives is of a lady in Worley. And he says about this lady in Worley, this is one of the great phenomena of Lancashire. She had two horns from her to the back of her head. No, then, if you believe what he says about that, you're dapt to be believed for the bird in the course. And the list is tremendous. And people listening to this might think, well, he's having his own. Because alphabetically, in the Birds of Lancashire of 1892, the first 10 American bittern, Balon's crake, black grouse, black throated wheat ear, double-breasted sandpiper, sail bunting, common cotton coal, crane, cream coloured courser, and Dartford wart. And you might think he's on his own. He's spinning the yarn. The factual. Because in Victorian times, when unusual birds came, they were shot. And nearly all these were specimens in museums either in Manchester or Lancaster or Bolton or all over the place. What amuses me most about Mr. Mitchell's book, and I hope it amuses you too, is the local names for some of our common, familiar species, especially the last one. Well, the first one is Billy Biter, the great tip. Bottle tit is the long-tailed tip. The wheat ear is a clodhopper. And when I was a lad, somebody had clodhoppers on big boots on them and jumping around them. A good one for Swift is Devil Screamer, the noise they make all the time at the end of the breeding season, in the breeding season. The greyhound is Frank, not Frank Horrocks, probably from the call. The puppet is Old White. And then he uses ladies' names to describe all the species. The yellowhammer is Bessie, the middle thrush is Shirley, the song thrush is Mavis, and the willow warbler is Millie Thumb. confusingly, there are four species which are called peggy, depending on where Lancashire is. White throat, lesser white throat, willow warbler, and chipshot are all called peggy. But the best of the lot is an archer, the flying toad. Well then, David, if this society ever had some hard times,
yes.
Stick a notice in the journal about a trip to North Wales Volcanic Chase where you're going to see flying toads. See what happens.
Okay. I'll remember that.
Archer, the flying toad.